I'll just talk about my background, I suppose, for a start. I've been in this industry for most of my working life, in Australia anyway, and I suppose I stepped into it from a frustration with farming, especially dairy farming. And me and my cousin decided that seed picking of native seed would be a good thing to do. So we could then do direct seeding in the Western District, and we used to collect lots and lots and lots of seed off trees, sometimes probably too much, and that was our way of getting by when we were sort of teenagers, like in our late teens. We try through our work to protect and enhance the remnant vegetation. And we are locals to this area. I'm from Drummond North, and I've been working in this area for, this will be 16 years this year, trying to protect and enhance what remnants we have left here through various means. So what we protect and try and enhance are everything that was here before, basically before white people turned up. And before we started doing things like farming, making roads, and chopping up the land into square bits and pieces. So we like to protect things even as small as grasses, little herbs, fungus, lichen, trees and shrubs as well. And we have a holistic approach, to doing that. In the hope of improving the health of the landscape, and what we want to do ultimately is protect wildlife through enhancing and protecting vegetation. They both go hand in hand. Insects, reptiles, amphibians, mammals, fish, anything you can think of, that's what we like, as long as it's supposed to be here. Things like, when I said insects, I don't mean European wasps. I have a little bit of a war going on with them this year, as probably most people do. I did 44 nests on my own property. I only own 30 acres. And quite a good year for European wasps. In the end, what I'm after is the ability of my kids and their kids and their kids to be able to see the stuff that I've seen. And I know for a fact that a lot of the stuff around that my ancestors were interested in and did see are not around anymore. And that's a bit of a sad thing. We try to operate pretty sustainably, and we try to keep our work pretty local, and we love this area. It's quite a dynamic area, and it's a very important area as well. A lot of the water, flowing down to the Murray comes from here. And there's a lot of water that does come from here. And we've got ethics that are sort of based on the best way of doing things, the best way to do weed control, for example, or revegetation work. And that's what we stick to. And we keep it pretty real. Don't try and get too big for our boots or anything like that. And we try and keep our quality up if we can. So the things we do are flora and fauna surveys, weed control, re-veg, and we've planted, over a million plants. We do direct seeding. We poison and remove willows with machines or by hand. We do erosion control, mechanical removal of weeds. We do hand weeding, which means we get down on our hands and knees and into the nitty-gritty if we have to. We do fencing off of remnant vegetation, but fairly sort of, we don't like to get into farm fencing or anything like that. We do stuff where you might have to carry all the stuff in, through the bush and fence off an area of orchids or something like that. That's what we'd sort of be more interested in. We do fence off mine shafts as well, where there's good remnant vegetation around, where your average fencing contractor may not notice, but we'll find it as an important bit. And we do work with threatened species and state prohibited weeds as well. So just talking about weed control, I suppose the most important thing and the first thing to think of when you've got an area of weeds is to make a plan. And that's probably the most important bit. I think sometimes it's even more important than doing the work. And if you don't have the plan, and if you're not the time or the tools and the money and the knowledge all together, then I would suggest just to leave it alone and wait until you have got all those things together and in order before you start. It's not complicated or anything like that. It's just there's a few steps you've got to follow to be able to get a good result. And I think everyone really wants a good result, even if it's to enhance or to increase the value in a monetary sense of your land. If that gets you motivated to do weed control, then maybe it's a good idea. In the meantime, if you do leave it, it might be a good thing as well in some ways, because the weeds can also provide habitat, you know, and they can have a purpose. It depends on the weed, of course. Depends on how it's spreading. It depends on the area. Some weeds could be not too bad in one spot and then really bad in another district, you know, over the road, you know, 50 or 100 k's away. If you don't have all those things together, I'd suggest to leave it. We've spent probably $50,000, I suppose, on my 30 acres over 15 years. So there's an indication of what some degraded land can sort of cost you over that time. And I've still got plenty more I could spend on the place. And I get some pretty cheap labour to be able to give me a hand. I know a few people. Allocate the time and the money for the project. We'd make a minimum of a 5-year plan, but we suggest a 10-year plan to do your weed control, depending on how bad it is. And I think just keeping on going back for your whole life is probably a good thing. I'm in the 15th year of my 10-year plan. So the aim of the project, we need to work that out. Do we want to control the spread of the weed? Do we want to make it neat looking? Is the area farmed or is it not farmed? What do we need to do and what do we need to not do? I suppose we want to do the minimum we can to improve the health, in the biodiversity and the ecology of that area. We specialise in waterways and we always have. And the reason for that is we find, especially in this area around here, the waterway to be, for us, the most important part of this landscape, which is why projects like this one are so important. And up here we can get, we can take some steps towards improving the health of the waterway, but also the quality of the water and the ecology of the water and the diversity of life in the water, and that's pretty important considering how, you know, dry Australia can be. The other thing to remember is that the most important part of weed control is follow up, and if you don't make the time to follow up, it can be very, very costly. And we see this all the time with our work, where we might even spend $10,000 on mulching an area of weeds, then say gorse or something like that, or blackberries, and nothing's done from there on because $10,000 has been spent. And then probably within a couple of years, you're probably looking at about $10,000 to do the same job again. So with the follow-up, that may have only been $1,000 or $2,000, so you're $8,000 out of pocket. The follow-up is the most important thing, and without follow-up, it's a waste of money. So we have to identify what a weed is. Some things are weeds, some things aren't weeds. Some things might be really bad weeds in one spot, and this is a very dynamic sort of area because you've got different catchments fairly close to each other. Most of them flowing north at this point anyway. and there's different transition areas and of change of vegetation from wetter areas that way to drier areas that way. A lot of different soil types, a lot of different dynamics due to that. So a weed may be a native plant as well, and I think we all know of things like cootamundras and Sydney green wattles or acacia decurrens and things like that. They're still native plants, and in the 80s there was a lot of native plant plantings, and in some places they've sort of got out of hand, and probably may not have been a great idea in hindsight, but that's sort of all changed now and we're all leaning towards more indigenous plants. But this area here to me is a transition area between say red gum and manna gum, which you would find down there, and red gum, which you would find over there. It's probably around about here somewhere where all this changes. My place is also a transition area between sort of box or drier area, say Alphinstone North, to things like messmate, candle bark, and manna gum. Towards say Spring Hill, and there's a distinctive difference there. There's also a difference in say a change from prickly Moses and things like those sort of prickly sort of species to spreading wattle or paradoxo, what's that called, hedge wattle, things like that, which is sort of further north. So there's a distinctive change there as well. And if you compare that to, say, somewhere from Echuca to Swan Hill, where it's a floodplain where seed can be smeared around and flooded out, and there may not be so much change in vegetation there as what may be here. So what I'm saying is that if you went and grabbed a heap of red gums and planted them way up there, for us, and we are purists in this field, it would be considered a weed. Anyway, what weeds that we are more concerned about, and we probably are more, known to everyone, would be blackberries. Look, I can see a big patch of them over there, and there's a big patch that runs way back from there to there. You can see hawthorns. I used to see a lot of willows here, but I can't seem to see many anymore. And you've got your thistles. There's plenty of different thistles, especially on this black puggy soil, including California thistle, which is, I'm not exactly sure what it's called, a regionally prohibited weed, I think. There's lots of different classifications, which I don't know that much about. See a lot of St. John's wort around. And I think, what we do is we try and control these weeds without having any negative impact on water or on the balance and diversity of the area. Because once that's lost, that's pretty hard to get back. So I usually bring a spray unit, but usually we do these talks on the weekend and they're all being used. But we use some pretty fancy sort of spray units that have 200 metre hoses. So we could probably hit that patch of blackberry from a spray unit that's sitting here by just walking that way with a hose. And when we're finished spraying it, we push a button and then it retracts itself, which is cheating, and then it comes back. They're a bit expensive, but they're really good, and they're called quick spray units, and they're quick at spraying. It makes spraying quicker, and they come in really handy, and so we use them a lot. I've brought some other things here that may be helpful for you, may not be, but these are the things that we've bought that we can use and abuse, and they last. So it's worth noting, because we've gone through pretty much all of them, and these are the ones that are the toughest. You see now, just give me a minute. So anyway, we find with our cutting, well, I suppose I should talk about cutting and painting first. We do spray a lot of weeds, but a lot of the time we don't think that spraying is particularly a great option. We try and cut down the use of chemicals. I don't trust any chemicals at all. People say that glyphosate is not such a toxic chemical, but I reckon it is. I reckon it's probably one of the worst ones. And so we always use our protective equipment. We always make sure that if we have to spray, it's the last resort in a way. We'd rather use not use herbicides at all, but it's sort of a bit hard to avoid, and so we do mulching as well with a posi track mulcher, which is a bobcat with tracks, and we can mulch massive areas with that machine. But once again, follow up is an important thing. I'm also very hesitant to use it at certain times of year because, as you know, gorse and blackberries are good habitat for birds, and birds are one of the things that we really like, especially native birds. If there was a lot of blackbirds in there or something, then probably we'd be quite happy to mulch it. So at certain times of year, and it depends on the season, birds may have a few clutches of chicks in a year if it's a really good year. So we actually go and check to see if there's birds around or not, believe it or not, before we do that. But if we have smaller areas where there's really good remnant vegetation around, we might use this machine with this particular blade. And I've shown it to people before. It's called a chisel tooth blade, and it's a magnificent tool. You can sharpen it like a chainsaw, and it, we put it on, this is an FS450, this machine, but you don't need something that big and heavy. This is 15 years old, this machine. It's never missed a beat. So if you look at it that way, I think they're maybe $1,800 or $1,900, but over that time, it's been well worth it. And I would say this machine would have cleared in excess of 20 acres of gorse over the years. So, and that may have been a little patch at the time. But when we would use this is especially if there is some good remnant vegetation with only a little bit, it's all relative, but a little bit of, say, gorse or other woody weeds around. And we'd cut it with this, with the chisel tooth blade. They're available in town at Bolton's. And then we would paint it. So if you're doing a small scale, you might use this. This is a tough little thing. It's just a top pump. It just pulls up and down, up like that, pumps it down. And you can just cut, and then you have to bend over a bit more, but you can squirt each stem as you go along. And you might use these instead. I think I bought these from Ben Hunter Motors in town, believe it or not, Takano. And these have been abused, and these are probably 10 years old, and they still cut. So you could use this and this, and you'd be surprised at how much you can do in a day just with that, and that's with gauze. Otherwise, you could use that for a broader scale and use this one. And these I buy from Bolton's, Elders in town. They've got all these. I'm not sure how much these are, but they're also just a top pump like that, and they're really tough. So you can, as long as you don't drive over them, I'm pretty sure they'll be pretty, they'll last you a while. We also use chainsaws. I've got a little top handle one in the car. It's just a really light little one, and we might use that more for stem injecting trees. which means putting a series of cuts into the trees and squirting with either that or that, just some glyphosate into those cuts. So there's always timing that needs to be considered with these types of activities, and timing is everything. I'll touch on that a little bit later, and if you have any questions about certain weeds and the stuff, you can ask me as well, and feel free to ask me any questions as we go along. So for now I'll just talk about spraying. Obviously we use chemicals for spraying, and the most common ones you would probably use yourself or on any farm would be Garlon or Grazon, glyphosate Garlon and Grazon are triclopyr or picloruns. Glyphosate is your Roundup and stuff like that, and metsulfuran methyl is brush off. We use mainly Garlon, and Garlon would not kill pretty much anything around here because it's all grass, so it's not going to kill any monocots. It's only going to kill dicots, so something that grows initially out of a seed with two little leaves, it will kill. So that includes thistle, poplar, hawthorn, eucalypts, patches of gorse like that down there. We usually spray, say for example, we spray gorse once the ground warms up in spring. That may not be the start of spring, maybe a little bit later. And we can spray it up until, with Garlon, you can spray it up till the end of summer and get pretty good results. We're still spraying blackberry at the moment. You can see the leaves are starting to go quite red and they're shutting down, but we still get really good results on blackberries up until about right now.
With Garlon,
yep. And a wetting agent, of course. And a dye. But dyes are something that you need to be really wary of if you're going to be spraying. The cheaper dyes that last, that show up better, are quite toxic, and I by all accounts they're more toxic than most chemicals. There's a chemical called rhodamine in red dyes, like red eye and a few others. It's really good. It makes things really red, but it also makes people really sick, and it's been strongly linked to cancers, although a lot of things have been strongly linked to cancers. I can name one. I can show you one. I just happen to have one here in my car. Or do I? Yes, I do. I'm also a sales consultant for Herbie Dye. I'm not, but that's the best one, and we've tried them all. Herbie Dye liquid that you can get from Elders in Kyneton. I don't work for Elders in Kyneton either. That's about $165 though, but it's not going to kill you. It's got, I don't even know what it's called, diazo. I don't know what that means. It sounds, anyway, that's okay to use on weeds, and we put about 150ml per 100 litres in, and it shows up quite fine. A little bit more on blackberries. It seems to not be quite as visible on blackberries for some reason. So we don't use much glyphosate. We try not to. If you had an area here of nice little herbs and nice little grasses and even lamandras and a good diversity of indigenous vegetation here, and I just took that backpack over there and just went like that, the odds of ever getting that back again in that way are pretty much impossible. It's just lost forever. And the only thing that's going to come up would be mainly, there could be some hard seed things, indigenous stuff could come up. But that diversity of tiny little things that you see, they're never going to come back. You're going to get little bits of thistle and you know, who knows what else. And John's wort, yep, some grass, some vernal grass, or who knows what sort of, you know, feral grass is going to come up. That's why we think you have to be pretty careful with glyphosate. For cutting and painting, glyphosate's excellent, you know, because it's just being squirted onto onto a stem. In a paddock where you're doing some type of plantings or something like that, it can be quite handy as well. But we actually scalp the ground with mattocks. It's a bit harder. We scrub a square like that because we try not to use chemicals on it if we can. And where there's a lot of couch grass and things like that and we want to re-veg, we will. We'll spray a big square. But that scalp actually works really well. And you go back there, I went to a site down in Sedonia the other day that we scalped. And it's quite a wet area, so you'd think there'd be some sort of growth, but we scalped out those, it was early spring, and there's still nothing there. It's just a nice little pan, and the plants are growing beautifully inside them. So it works really well, and you don't have to use glyphosate. Brush off is also a handy tool. It's a bit of a grey area how it works. Brush off is metsulfuran methyl, and we use it for weeds like Watsonia and bridal creeper, bulby things that grow under the ground that you don't really see so much. Gladiolus, there's a lot of gladiolus that you see these days growing along creeks, and you can just dribble it onto this. It's just like a single leafed sort of gladiolus undulatus. It's just a funny looking single fat leafed thing. It also works really well on that. So we use brush off with it. It's supposed to be for woody weeds, but if you make the mix a little bit too strong, it can have pretty bad effects. It can be residual as well. But I've also read reports of experiments that were done on mice with brush off, which is nice, not for the mice, but they fed mice salt, just normal salt, and then they fed the mice brush off, and they died quickly, well, more quickly on normal salt than they did on brush off. So I don't know what that means at all. There's one chemical we don't use, and it's available off the shelf, called Torden or 2,4-D. It's been in the news lately, actually, regarding use of it in the 90s by the department. I don't know which one. It might have even been Parks, or I'm not sure who was using it, but protective equipment back in the 80s and you know, late 80s and 90s was not, personal protective equipment was not as important as what it is now, or it wasn't pushed on us as much as it is now. And there, it's been strongly linked to cancer as well, like undoubtedly. 2,4-D mixed with 2,4,5-T, which is outlawed now, is Agent Orange. It was what they used, Agent Orange, and we know what that did to people. So what we use is long sleeves and long pants. Try not to wear shorts, no top or anything. And we use this mask, is the best mask you can buy. And it's not cheap once again, but it will last a long time. It's made by Sunstrom, and there's a few different types, but this is a latex, I think, the blue one, and it's soft and it doesn't hurt your face. You can wear it, no, I won't say all day, but you can wear it for much longer than the other ones, and it's a really good investment because you're protecting yourself from breathing it in and it getting into your bloodstream. However, there's a quicker way for it to get into your bloodstream, and that's through your eyes. That's the quickest way. So these goggles are the best that we've found. Pro X, Pro something. We got these from Pro Choice. We got these from, you can get them from most safety joints anyway, in Bendigo somewhere. What about it? Elders in Kyneton. Coincidentally, we're local, so we get stuff from there because, well, they get stuff that we want for, you know, they order it in for us and we say we want. I just picked them up today because the other ones we've had for probably 6 years, and they're starting to get a bit ratty now, so we just get another couple, and they pay for themselves anyway. So I was talking about timing. So with blackberries, we spray them from Christmas time on. We don't spray them before Christmas. If you spray blackberries before Christmas, it burns them right down. It looks awesome. They look dead, but then they'll sprout back up again because of the way they operate, I suppose. Which is a bit frustrating at times, because you can spray gorse and you'll go to a spot where there's gorse and blackberries and you'll know, well, we're going to have to come back. But that's when you think it'll be more efficient to leave the whole job and we'll come back after Christmas when there's a crossover between the two weed species. We do a lot of tree poisoning of trees, and there's a few different ways there's different ways to manage different types of trees. These poplars here, I see them being fallen all the time by tree removalists. And what happens with poplars when you just chop them, even if you paint the stem, the stump, is that the roots, which probably come way past here, then, because they're such shallow roots as well, they basically sprout up everywhere, and you get thousands and thousands and thousands. Like this big area here might be all poplars. It might only shoot up a few, but I've seen them shoot up thousands and thousands, which means then you're going to have to go back and spray all of those probably for a few years before you can get on top of that situation. So instead of doing that, what we do is put a series of cuts into the stem of that poplar and squirt fairly neat Roundup into it, and it then takes the poison down into the roots. You can do it, you could even do it now, it's getting a little bit late for the poplar, but it'll still work. It'll take it down because everything's shutting down, which means nutrients are more likely to be going down into the roots, and it'll take it down and then kill it from the ground as well. And it's the same with willows and a few others. Some willows you can just chop, and some it's better to poison first. Like we can chop twisted willows and weeping willows and other things like that, and just paint them. And with crack willows, we poison them first and then remove later. That eliminates, clone. Well, basically, crack willows are really good at cloning themselves, so a little branch like that might be another tree in a few years. So what we do is poison them first and then think about removing them later, or not remove them. It just depends on what the situation is, what's downstream, what infrastructure's there, is it a public area or not, do we really need to remove them? And if we don't, we just leave them to fall down. They turn to dust over 5 or 10 years, they're pretty much gone. And the willows don't really do much, in my opinion, for habitat or the health of the waterway. There's a huge amount of problems with willows, and that's one of the reasons why the CMA's taken out all these willows here. I'm pretty sure you could probably go on the website. Is there information on willows on your website, Angela? There's a willow management guide inside on the table. It'd be really good to, it might be one or two positive points to willows and a thousand negatives. So we're better off without them. Hawthorns are can be good habitat for birds and stuff like that. We like to leave them if we can standing. So all we do is we get our little top handle chainsaw here, which is really light, and you can, we try not to use one hand, but you can just cut into the side of the stem. as low down as you can, so below the branches. You might even trim a few branches off. Series of cuts there, maybe three there. Squirt some neat Roundup into it, and leave it standing. You can chop it at the base, fall it and paint the stem, and that's fine, and you won't get any it won't spread, but then you've got an awkward sort of mass there as well. When we stem inject them and leave them, they stand for a few years, and then, you know, birds can still use them as perches and, you know, use them to ambush their prey, for example. We can also chop them. I've had a few problems with being pinned underneath them, falling them, thinking they were going to go one way and not quite exactly getting it right, and that's not very nice at all. They're quite spiky, as you know. That's why they're called hawthorn. We don't use a lot of grazon because of the picklerum in it, and we use it. Picklerum should not be used anywhere near water. One of the main things that we try and do is not adversely affect the ecology of water, working near water a lot. So we don't use a lot of grazon. Grazon is quite an effective chemical because it's essentially garlon with an extra chemical in it and an extra salt in it. So it's a tough old thing. But we also do a lot of work around remnant vegetation, and so if you've got a big one, it's really quite hard to spray it without getting a little bit of overspray around it. In a paddock it might be fine, but what we do is sum up the difference between going along with this thing and just going, yeah, squirt, or spending the time going like this. So what's going to be quicker? Spraying maybe a tiny bit quicker, but you don't always get it. They're a pretty tough one. If you use garlon, you will get sprouting back from the base as well, or up the stem sometimes. It's not that effective. So, and Roundup, well, try and stay away from it anyway. So, yeah, hawthorns are really quite good to get later on in the season, so say from Christmas onwards. We've had a little bit less success at the start of the season. We've had more success with desert ash, and desert ash isn't such a problem here, but it is definitely in Bendigo, and we're talking about Bendigo Creek. It's one of the worst weeds around, as in it's hardest to kill out of any of the trees that we try and kill. But we've had better success as it buds at the start of the season, better than we do at the end, and that's stem injecting and cutting and painting. So I'm not sure why scientifically why that is either, but that's just the way that happens.
What about elms?
Yeah, elms, they're an interesting one because they sort of do a similar thing to what happens when you chop one of these down, and you know, and they spread all over the place. So what we try and do normally is reduce the mass of it first, whether that's mulching or even pushing it up with a machine, and that depends on the site. And it's important to remember, you know, your cultural heritage issues and stuff like that if you're scalping or pushing up vegetation. If it's on crown land, then you do come across these cultural heritage issues. So what we do is try and reduce that biomass by various means, even if it's by hand, and then we spray that regrowth. That's the only way that we can do it. We can mulch pretty big stuff. Like we can mulch probably elms up to about 300 mil because they're very soft with our machine. So it's a way of controlling it. The bigger ones we'd also like to ring bark and put poison into that stem as well first, and leave it, and then do our biomass reduction later on. With the willows, it's the same thing, slightly different to the hawthorns, where we put a series of cuts in. We actually ring bark the whole willow all the way around. This is cracked willows, and squirt poison into those cuts, and we get pretty good results all year round. I think the optimum time would be up to around about now, from Christmas up to about now, but we get pretty good results all the way around. Even if we do get that re-sprout at the start of the season, I think we didn't do it right. Well, then they seem to just die off after that anyway. So yeah, timing's everything. If you're going to be doing this costly and time-consuming exercise, it's good to try and inform yourself on when to do it, because otherwise you put all this effort in and you get nothing back for it. And just one other thing about chemicals, there's a lot of generic Chinese chemicals on the market, and we're a bit suspicious of the, of some of them, because they aren't as stable as some of the others, and sometimes they don't seem to be quite as effective. Apparently they're not chemically as stable as some of the others, so you get you can have some adverse effects from those chemicals too. So we sort of stick with the main sort of brand names, I suppose.
So how do you know you've got a Chinese chemical?
It'll say packaged in Australia. It'll just say triclopyr 600 or something like that. But it's basically made in China.
So one of the lesser known brands.
Yeah, yep. But you can always ask them to find out for you from the shop, and I think they should feel obliged to do that for you as well. You've also got some problems around here with needle grasses, and they're a bit of a problem that we come up against quite a bit. And if you go down, north of, say, Turpin's Falls, there's hundreds and hundreds of acres of needle grass. And that's what can happen with the stuff. But what we usually do is, I mean, we look at that and we think, we can't do anything about that. But where we treat it is where it's in amongst native stiper grasses. And it gets very confusing because some of them look quite similar and at times almost impossible to tell. So we have to wait until there's seed on it before we can sort of tell sometimes, because we don't want to kill the native grass and it's sort of all intermixed together. So it's a tough one and something that's well worth familiarising yourself with in case you do find it, because even if it's on council land or government managed land, it's a good thing to try and get them to control it before it takes over. So I think I'll just talk a bit about fire. Years ago we used to do a lot of fire control, and yesterday we were looking at a job on a roadside at Spring Hill that was sprayed. It was some quite big, in a big area of broom, Cape broom and blackberry. And we were trying to do some follow up on it, which is the most important thing. There was a carpet, a considerable amount of broom coming up through an almost impenetrable jungle of dead sticks. And it was, you had to wear safety glasses just to walk through it because there's little sticks everywhere. And it made access very difficult. There was nothing of any great value at all from an Indigenous perspective on the site. And we really thought that this was a great spot to do a burn because it would have reduced that biomass of debris, basically, of rubbish. And it also would have cracked the seed, broom having a fairly hard seed, and promoted a huge amount of germination, which may even jump you ahead in control, quite a few years, arguably. So if we burnt that like we used to years and years ago before, basically before our insurance company said we won't allow you to do it anymore. If we had been able to burn that site and follow up in that way, I think it would be a much more effective way of controlling that particular spot. There's obvious risks with fire, and controlling it. There's risk from our point of view of being able to guarantee our ability to be able to burn it or to be able to control it. And on waterways, it may not be such a relevant thing to do, especially not on a broad scale, because it may affect that water quality as well. It can be used efficiently though, and but it can also antagonise an area, and sometimes it's better just to leave it. I'm not sure that these areas around here would have been slashed and burned, you know, by Aboriginals in, you know, in a historical sense at all. And I don't think that, you know, the forest around here really responds that well to, you know, broad-scale burning on a regular basis. So if you've got an area that's got some great biodiversity and some good forest litter around, and it's been designated for a burn, I'm not sure that that's the greatest way to go down that track. Sometimes the first thing to come back and things that can get into this barren soil are weeds. It can also burn out habitat, good habitat, old habitat, you know, big hollows, and obviously that's the sort of thing that government departments try to minimise, but it's a tough one to be able to. Some weeds respond pretty well to fires, and a lot of the controlled fires that we have are not particularly hot, so it doesn't control those weeds as much as what a really hot burn would. And we had a fire in Drummond 2 weeks before Black Saturday, and it was an extremely hot fire, and the bush responded really well to the fire. Obviously there were some you know, wildlife lost and things like that, and habitat lost, but in the long term, which is what we're trying to work towards, the long term, I think it was a pretty good thing. The first thing to come back was lichen, and so that made it look pretty interesting, a very orange looking lichen. And then some annual weeds colonised the area, and we thought, oh no, this isn't going to be good. But then the native or indigenous stuff came through, and we saw very little gorse, and there was a significant amount of gorse on that site. We saw very little gorse coming through until a later stage, but that gave the indigenous stuff a chance to take off, which then, well, we had a chance to do some, you know, quite fiddly but worthwhile weed control on the gorse once it started to germinate as well. And I'm sure a lot of that gorse seed did get fried by the hot burn, because there's not as much around as there used to be at all. That's a really hot fire, something that we can't really do, because it's extremely dangerous. I forgot to mention this Solo 475. That's a tough one as well, and they're not that expensive. I think they're $175, but they'll last a long time as well. And you can put 10 litres in. I think it's a 15, but you can put 10 in it. It's only 10 kilos. You can walk around and do a huge amount of work with it. It's great. And quite a comfortable one. They don't seem to leak very much, and you don't end up with a red back or anything like that. So we've tried a lot of Swiss-made ones and all other types of ones, and they're pretty good, but they're also more than double that price of that one. So on a commercial level, they might be pretty good, but for the average, you know, landholder and something like that, that one's probably better.